Namaskaram. A very warm welcome from Bharata First. My name is Bharna and we are doing this Sunday special show. Today we have with us a very special guest, Ms. Seenu Joseph, who is the co-founder of Maitri Speaks Trust and also a women's health educator. She has extensively traveled across India since 2009 to understand ancient menstrual practices and their impact on women's health. She also has authored books such as Women and Sabrimala and Rutu Vidya. Both books so amazing that I would personally recommend every adolescent or adult to read. Namaskaram, Seenu ma'am. Welcome to Bharata First. It's a great honor to have you on our show.
Namaskaram, Bhavna, and to all the viewers. It is absolutely my pleasure to be here. And thank you so much for reading the book and then inviting me. I really appreciate that, Bhavna.
Ma'am, whenever I think of menstrual health and ancient practices in our culture, you are the first person I can think of to demystify it for our viewers. Beginning with that, I think one of the most common questions that people often have is about why menstruation is a taboo, especially in our culture when we have temples like the Kamakhya Temple of Assam or the Chengannur Bhagwati Temple in Kerala. These are the temples where we worship the deity, basically the Devi, who is actually menstruating. So what is our culture? Is it something that we keep the menstruation part as a hush-hush thing, or is it something that we embrace and talk about openly?
That's a very pertinent question, Bhavna, to begin this discussion. And see, one of the things, fundamental rule about understanding our cultural practices, which are derived from the Shastras and the Vedas, is this rule that there are no contradictions. If something seems contradictory, it means our understanding is not complete. So this is the first and foremost rule we must all keep in mind when we're trying to decode any of the practices in the Hindu tradition. So as you rightly said, how can it be that on one hand, we have Devi temples like the temple of Ma Kamakhya or Chengannur Bhagwati Devi temple, where the menstruation of Devi itself is a big festival. And so many lakhs of people come to be there because she is considered to be so auspicious and powerful at that time. So how can we have that? And on the other hand, what you just referred to as taboo, right? It's a contradiction. And the truth is that one of these two things are not correct. Now, obviously, the menstrual festivals are correct because it is there for us to see and witness. So the other aspect of what we refer to as menstruation being a taboo in our culture, that is the understanding which is incorrect and contradictory. Why is it like that? See, the first thing you must remember, the word taboo, it's not an Indian word. It does not feature in any of our Indian languages. And in English, it comes with a negative connotation because that is how the West views this subject. It was never that way in India. You have, if you're familiar with any of the states in South India, I'm sure you're aware how menstruation is a celebration. The first time the girl comes of age, the entire village, if it is in a rural area, entire village is invited to celebrate this coming of age of a woman. It is unthinkable that the word taboo even gets associated with the subject in India. But as we lose touch with our culture and the reasons and especially the science behind it, we simply start mimicking the Western language. You know, when I was invited for a conference in 2015, it was an international conference in Boston, and I was a key panelist representing India. So they put up this map, a world map, and they marked all the places, all the countries across the globe where they said menstrual taboos exist. Okay, so it is not just India, it's around the world. Many African nations were covered in it. Many of who you refer to as developing nations, they were all covered in it. And I suggested to them, why are you calling it a taboo? These are simply cultural practices that many ancient societies across the world followed. They followed it because they revered menstruation. We never looked at it as a taboo. That is an imposition of the English language. It is not native to us. So where I come from, you know, Karnataka, so we say sutka. Sutka, generally, when you use that word, it means she needs rest. let her be. That it's a period of rest that she has to go through. We did not associate such negativity with it. So first and foremost is those few of us who are representing India are unfortunately urban Indian women. And we are more and more increasingly becoming cut off from our cultural roots. And we are speaking only the English language, and therefore we are conveying the wrong message about it. Menstruation never was and still is not a taboo in the Hindu tradition. And there is no contradiction between the fact that we worship menstruation of Devi, and back home, when women menstruate, she is also considered the same way. Where this understanding is missing, it is because we have lost connect with the culture and the meaning of it, and not because inherently in Hindu tradition there's a stigma or a taboo. That is definitely a false notion.
Right. So, you know, ma'am, the part where you mentioned about the ceremonies. So one such ceremony was done for me when I reached Mannar. My family hails from the south, even though we don't live there, but we followed the entire 1 week long tradition with my aunts cooking different kind of food for me every day. And they were like very specific foods like jaggery or coconut that they would use in the food. So I think it was probably the lack of understanding of why they're doing what they're doing. That is what creates the entire air of confusion probably. But yes, women are actually treated like goddesses during that time. That's absolutely true.
As you said, you know, in all the states in South India, there are these ceremonies associated with Mannar cave where the girl is dressed like a princess and showered with gifts and blessings. And this is not a woman-only ceremony. Her brothers, her uncles, all the neighbors who are men, they are also part of this. In fact, in one of the villages in Karnataka, when I happened to be interacting with an MLA, that particular day he said, no, I have to go. And we asked why and where. He said, no, this is Menake ritual of the girl in the village. So the MLAs are invited to it. It is that big a deal. And if we delve a little deeper into it, we will begin to understand, as I have explained in my book, the science behind why it is important to celebrate these rituals. And this is not exclusive to South Indian states. There was a time in India when these practices existed across the nation. In central regions, northern regions, even now Assam has similar celebrations. But because of different issues historically, the invasions we went through, people did not want to announce a girl's coming of age because there were others who could take advantage of it. And that's when we lost these practices. But across North India, the ceremony of Gauna, which is in fact a part of the marriage rituals in many cases today, it was nothing but the celebration of Menarche. So it existed across India and we have completely lost track of it in many parts of India. And that's the unfortunate thing.
Right. Ma'am, with the increasing influence of social media, I must say, there is this other issue that has been coming out, which is that people are talking about menstruation in a very negative light by calling it a monthly problem. And some people even go to the extent of saying that they wish they never menstruated or it did not exist for women. So can you please elaborate on the lines why menstruation is not a monthly problem? Like you've explained in your book, it's rather a detox time. So what do you mean by that?
No, that's such a beautiful and important question, especially for urban activists and women who have come to associate menstruation with so much problem. Now, if you think of it, the reason, Bhavna, why women are calling it menstrual problem, we can't really blame them because majority of these women who look at it as a problem go through intense physical and emotional disturbance at this time. You know, it has become so common that we are starting to think it is normal to have period pain. We're starting to think it is normal to have mood swings, normal to feel bloated, normal to feel, you know, nauseated, normal to not have an appetite. It is not normal for these things to happen. And every woman's period can be a beautiful experience, completely devoid of all this physical and emotional pain. That is the first and foremost thing that women have to realize. And the reason why they're calling it a problem or do not want this to happen is because they are suffering. And two, because they don't see the value of this phenomenon beyond the biological thing of having a child. as more and more women are perhaps deciding not to want to have their own biological children, there is this question of, should I still menstruate? What is the purpose of this? And these are the confusing notions that previously was never there, because even today, if you go to a village and ask the women, why do women menstruate? We did this as part of our surveys. And I would have, you know, options, and I would have this, okay, childbirth is a number one option, but hardly any woman said that. You know what they would say instead? Why do you menstruate? Because it is good for your health. Because it makes sure that you don't have these chronic lifestyle diseases that men develop after a certain age. You menstruate because then your bones are healthy. You don't put on a lot of weight. Your eyesight is better. I mean, these were the kind of reasons that rural women were giving. And I was so shocked in the beginning. And that's when I started digging deeper, because here were women who seemed to know a lot more about menstruation that we have completely not been aware of, because our education system only says menstruation equals capacity to have a child. And if that came out of the equation, the question is, why menstruate? Why bother with it? Yes. Yes, Bhavna.
I cannot think of a single urban woman who would take any of those things. They wouldn't know anything beyond, you know, the reproductive use of menstruation.
Absolutely. And so what I want to share through your channel is a few bits about why menstruation is so much more than that, and why a woman must never even consider removing her uterus, even if she's going through, you know, she's reached menopausal years. See, in Ayurveda, my Ayurveda physician told me this beautiful thing. For a woman, it's like her second heart. Just as you cannot even imagine taking your heart and throwing it away, you should not do that to your uterus, because many of the important processes happen via the uterus for a woman. The regulation of all your doshas as per Ayurveda, the absorption of calcium, all of these things are facilitated by the uterus. Okay, so one of the important views or perspectives that Ayurveda provides is of menstruation as a detox. What do we mean by a detox? What do we need to flush out from our system? Detox essentially means that there's something internal which you need to flush out, right? So in Ayurveda, we understand the concept of ama or amaras. Ama refers to the internal toxins in a person's body, male or female. That comes because we don't eat healthy food. So if you consume food that is very difficult to digest, only a portion of it gets absorbed and assimilated. Only a portion of it gets excreted. But there is one portion of it which is difficult to go through these processes and simply sits and rots in your intestine. When it rots like that, it releases or creates what we call ama. Some of the Ayurveda texts refer to ama as ama visha, as in it is a poisonous substance in your body, which is the root cause of most of the diseases and disorders. The more ama is there in our system, the more it affects our immunity. It even affects our fertility. If it goes to an extent where it is excessive in our body, it even affects our fertility. And that is why built into our culture, we have the Ekadashi and all other occasions where you fast. The reason for this fasting is to clear your system of ama. Now, what happens on a day-to-day basis is, as you keep consuming unhealthy food and your metabolism is not good because perhaps you're not exercising, then most of the food that you're consuming is sitting and rotting and forming ama. Menstruation is that gift of nature where every month, through this natural process, the ama is pushed out of your system. So some women may experience it through their skin breaking out as acne. Some women may experience it as severe cramps in their abdomen, which is nothing but gastric issues. Some women experience it as loose motions, because that's your lower digestive tract trying to clean out the ama. Some of you experience it as nausea and vomiting because there's so much ama collected in the upper digestive tract. So all your menstrual problems are directly associated with how much ama you have accumulated over the month. and your body is trying to do you a favor by flushing this out of your system. And because you get this natural detox every month, you don't have major health issues as long as you are menstruating. Whether you see cardiac problems, chronic lifestyle issues like diabetes or high blood pressure, it happens for men because they don't have an equivalent detox mechanism. So for men, they have to do everyday yoga, everyday sadhana. There are very strict processes, different thing they're not doing. But for women, you do nothing. You just relax. Every month it happens for you. So if your period is problematic and troublesome, you need to remember that it is an indication, a direct indication of how much armor you have accumulated. And the period that you curse is nature's gift of helping you get rid of this with minimal effort on your part. With simple measures of eating healthy a week before and during your period, following the traditional practices of not having certain types of food and having, you know, the moong dal ki khichdi without salt. These kind of things are there because it helps us clear our system naturally. And when you make yoga and pranayama part of your daily routine, not to be done during menstruation, but you make it part of your daily routine, it balances your doshas and help you metabolize food faster. So even if there is ama getting collected, it is also getting equally released because your bowels and your digestive system is functioning well. These are simple things that women can try at home and experience themselves why periods does not have to be a monthly problem. So this is the physical part. Similarly, there is the attitude and the emotion towards menstruation. The minute you associate anger, negativity, embarrassment towards this, your body goes into a stress response. And the minute you go into a stress response, your period gets affected. So it is so important that women understand these simple things. And it is not new. This is the traditional knowledge that your grandmother can tell you. It is only up to you to listen to it with an open mind and start using it to experience a problem-free period. And it is within every woman's capacity to experience a problem-free period.
Right. Very well explained, Sinu ma'am. I also feel bad for men that they don't have such a natural detox way that their body can cleanse out all the ama. And right before this interview, I was actually reading a report of UNICEF. Like, they do these campaigns in India about menstruation. One of them was very shocking, where they said that your menstruation and the food you eat has nothing to do. Like, they have no relation whatsoever. You can eat anything and like it won't affect your flow.
In fact, yes, you're right, because they don't have this understanding of food. See, Ayurveda is the only science which talks of food as therapeutic, food as medicine. Every single thing you eat will affect your health. I'll just tell you the simple thing which women can try. You know, traditionally they say don't eat papaya. I'm not even talking of non-veg. Papaya don't eat during menstruation. Try eating papaya during menstruation and you can see how your pitta, your internal heat, will increase, causing you to bleed more heavily. Similarly, don't have curd or anything sour during menstruation, our grandmothers will tell us, because these also increase the pitta. At the same time, if you have something cold, you know, say, let's say your period has started and you're happily enjoying an ice cream, cold food will increase your vata dosh. And when your vata dosh is predominant and very high, your bleeding will again change and become scanty. Even the color of the blood will change and become dark brownish. So food that you eat will directly influence your period. And unless someone understands Ayurveda, they can never appreciate these things, even though they are going through it physically. You know, so many sports women are given the wrong advice by modern doctors. I've known sports women who go to the doctor because they're having heavy menstrual bleeding. Why? Because they train during menstruation, which traditionally women were never encouraged to. And when they're having heavy menstrual bleeding, they give them exactly food which will further aggravate it. And they bleed for 15-20 days at a stretch. Complete and utter ignorance of the science of food. But I'm so glad you brought it up, because UNICEF and all of them, anyone who's unaware of Ayurveda, will talk in such an ignorant manner. But it is up to women to observe their body and see when they follow the traditions that their grandmothers have told them, how different their experience of menstruation can be.
Yeah. Ma'am, my next question to you is about how West has better access to sanitation, menstrual hygiene products, healthcare, and yet the rates of menstrual health issues are so high in comparison with that of India. Also, in the light of the fact that UNICEF still comes out with campaigns in India teaching Indians about menstrual health.
Yes, that's funny, isn't it? because, you know, in somewhere in 2015-16, I began to privately study published research papers. When I say published, it means papers that are out there in the public domain that everyone has access to. I studied papers pertaining to menstrual health in India, menstrual health in other so-called developing nations like India. So Kenya, Nigeria, Philippines, Vietnam, I studied papers pertaining to them. And then I also looked at papers pertaining to so-called developed forward countries which have hygiene and sanitation and whatever. And I studied over 150 papers. I have published my findings in my blog, Maitri Speaks, along with citation of every paper that I have studied. So anyone who's interested can see those and dig out those papers. So what I found is so funny that if you did a comparison of menstrual health of women in India versus women in developed countries, the numbers are so starkly contrasting to the common conversation that they need to come and help us, that we will be surprised as to why no one is looking at this. First and foremost thing is that there is no study which says that beyond any doubt, menstrual hygiene as a subject has anything to do with menstrual health. So it does not matter what product you use, it will not lead to dysmenorrhea or period pain, menorrhagia or heavy menstrual bleeding, amenorrhea or delayed periods. Obviously, it does not lead to PCOD or endometriosis. So this whole focus and conversation on menstrual hygiene is obviously driven by product manufacturers and NGOs who are being funded by them. That's a very evident thing. But they have made the conversation so one-dimensional that if you just look at the data, let me simply tell you about heavy menstrual bleeding. In India, all the research papers put together, the prevalence was between 0.3% to around 20% women. So highest number, percentage of women in India experiencing heavy menstrual bleeding is around 20%. Do you know that in England, it is 52%? So basically, every second woman you meet there is going through heavy menstrual bleeding. Similarly, take period pain or dysmenorrhea. In India, the highest was among urban girls. Again, urban India is unfortunately imitating the West, and the trend is also moving that way. In rural India, it's around 40% or so. Urban girls goes as high as 72%, and I thought that was high. But then I looked at this study called MDOT study, which was done on teenagers across Australia. And I was shocked that 94% teenagers across Australia, 94% face dysmenorrhea or period pain. And in fact, that is the number one reason why they are dropping out of school and missing school during menstruation. So this whole thing that, oh, Indian girls are dropping out, missing school, it is such nonsense. In New York City, 42% girls have missed school because of period pain and dysmenorrhea. This is the reality of it. So as of today also, it is the Indian girls and women who have far lesser menstrual issues because the preventive mechanisms for menstrual disorders are weaved into our culture. So every time you follow that strict diet, every time you learn to take rest, every time you celebrate menstruation, it is not symbolic. You're preventing a menstrual disorder. And in the nations where they either do never had such a cultural knowledge or whether they have themselves actively killed it, you will see a direct correlation to menstrual health as being very, very bad state. And they are the ones who are trying to come and tell us what to do. It's really funny. And I'm glad you asked that question.
Yeah, because ma'am, I think this is probably like a subject that a lot of people in the beauty pageants take up as a cause for India most often for some reason.
So, you know, you can give as many sanitary pads as you want. It's not going to be back to school because no one is missing school owing to menstruation.
Exactly. And ma'am, also the rate that you spoke about, was it 72% for the urban women in India?
Urban girls, like, adolescent
yeah,
girls.
I mean, it is actually quite high to compare it to the rural places, yes, because we all have at least one female friend who suffers from PCOD or like, yes, heavy bleeding.
Yes, because we are proactively rebelling against the culture.
Yeah.
If your mother or grandmother says do this, you will proactively not do that.
Yes.
Rural areas, whether they agree with it, understand it or not, they will at least have obedience. And because of that, somehow their health is maintained. But in urban areas, we are rebelling to an extent that it is affecting our own health. And that is a sad thing. It is all right to question, but you must also make an attempt to dig deeper into your own culture. These things have existed for thousands of years. You know, the practices of women in India, the Hindu women, it is so astonishing that these are not really spelled out in many books. You know, for men, all what you should do, the Upanayanam ceremony, Sandhya Vandanam, all of that is written down. These things that women do have been handed down orally through generations of grandmothers. And why have they preserved it if it had no consequence on your health? Our mothers and grandmothers are not so foolish to just hang on to something if it is only symbolic. Every one of their practices directly impacts our health and prevents menstrual disorders. That is why they followed it and forced it onto you. Yes, they may not have been able to explain it because who teaches Ayurveda anymore? Those who don't have a seat in MBBS, they go to Ayurveda, unfortunately. These are not part of our education system. The knowledge of the sukshma sharira, of your doshas, of your vayus, who teaches you? So how could your grandmothers and your mothers have explained things to you without this language of Indian sciences? But this, right, their experiences and how they observed following these practices improved their health. That is why they retained it, and that is why they are telling you. Now it's up to you to do the learning, and that's what my book Ruthu Vidya is all about, to make that learning easy for you.
And ma'am, as we spoke about the menarche and the customs associated with it, do you think having a menarche ceremony of sorts, like the one I spoke about from my experience, does that affect your menstrual health later in life?
Absolutely. And such a beautiful question, because my very first chapter in the book is about menarche, the need for celebration, not a choice or an option, the need for celebration. Let me just pluck out a few of the things that happen in the menarche ritual and try to explain to you the science behind it so people who are listening can appreciate the purpose of it. First and foremost thing, as I spoke about earlier, it is important to develop positive attitude towards menstruation. You see, in our brain, there is a small portion called the hippocampus, and its role is to store and retrieve memory from time to time. So, take for example, there is an incident in your life. You were passing through a road and there was an accident. A month or two later, you go back on that same road. This time there's no accident. But do you not subconsciously go through the same stress and fear that you felt when that accident first happened?
Right? Yeah.
That is because when any episode happens in your life, it is like a photo that is taken and stored in the hippocampus. And every time you go into a similar situation, the hippocampus reminds you of that and your body responds to it as though it was happening the first time. This is called episodic memory. So for something like menstruation, which occurs month after month after month, if your first memory of it was negative, every subsequent period, your body will go into the same stress response as you felt in your very first period. And to prevent that, our ancestors went through all this trouble of making you feel so special and celebrating so that every month, unknowingly, you feel joyful when you have your period and your body doesn't go into stress. Because stress is the number one reason for irregular menstruation, which is increasingly becoming common among urban girls. In urban girls, though they do the celebration, instead of just surrendering and enjoying, they're always rebelling by just... it has become inbuilt into our nature to rebel. So even though it is a celebration, if you don't associate it with positive thinking and a deeper understanding of it, it could create stress in you. So try and understand. If jnana is your method rather than faith, then take jnana also to the complete end. No, don't just question and then leave it. Follow that question. Try and understand. So this is the first reason why it's so important to have a positive attitude. During my workshops with women, so many of them share how their period pain, just period pain, completely stops the minute they change their attitude towards menstruation. The minute you start feeling thankful, the minute you start feeling positive about it, your body will relax and your menstruation will ease up. It is such a simple thing. You need to try it and then you will know it through your experience. The other thing, Bhavna, as you mentioned, is the very specific diet that is there. So during the first period, you're given sesame. You are given dry coconut and jaggery as a combination. You are told not to have salt. You are given food prepared, made in urad dal or black gram, and khichdi, which is always made in moong dal. All of these food have a very specific role to play. In my book, I have published papers that show what goes through a woman's body when she menstruates. See, menstruation is the time when your body goes through a natural oxidative stress. Oxidative stress can be very damaging even at the cellular level. Now, during normal times in a woman's cycle, in fact, even during ovulation, her body goes through oxidative stress. But naturally, during ovulation, our hormone called estrogen is high. And estrogen is an antioxidant. So even though during ovulation, you're going through oxidative stress, estrogen balances it. But you know, during menstruation, estrogen is at an all-time low. So your body is going through oxidative stress and estrogen, which could have countered it, is flat. That is why through the food, you must make up for this oxidative stress process. And the food that is prescribed, all of it, sesame, turmeric, all of these are actually antioxidant in nature. They are very, very rich in antioxidants and prevent your body from going into a complete situation of oxidative stress. There are studies, published papers, which show that one of the reasons for primary dysmenorrhea or period pain is your body going into oxidative stress. There are studies which show that one of the reasons for infertility is the lack of B-complex vitamins. And your urad dal, your black gram, is very rich in B-complex vitamins. So instead of giving you synthetic versions of these vitamins, our ancestors made sure that the food itself you eat was such that it will make up for this loss. We lose iron. We need calcium during this time. And you see all the food, just look up the calcium content and iron and folic acid content of sesame, of urad dal, of moong dal. Very, very high in all of this. And because these are natural substances, your body absorbs it better. So every single food item that is traditionally recommended during menstruation plays an active role in preventing menstrual discomfort, not just now, but even going forward to prevent a lot of fertility and reproductive health issues, especially something like moong dal ki khichdi without salt, because salt increases oxidative stress. Without salt, it is recommended to be taken every month during your menstruation. In fact, as the only food, because your body is doing a detox, as we discussed. And this moong dal ki khichdi, it liquefies the ama. And because of its fibrous content, it eases its movement through the bowels and out of your system. It is like you're doing a natural panchakarma or a detox if you have moong dal ki khichdi without salt and without spices for 3 or 4 days during a period. At the end of it, your skin will glow because all the ama has been cleared from your system. That's how effective these things are. So do not take them lightly. Go back into your own tradition and culture and try to understand in a deeper way why these things were there and how it affects your actual experience of menstruation itself.
With this, we come to the end of our show. We realize that visiting temples during menstruation is a topic that is often discussed superficially because of lack of understanding behind the idea. Sinu ma'am has approached this topic holistically in her book Ritu Vidya, where she has explored it on a quantum physics and subtler human body levels. Similarly, the book also in depth explains more of our ancient wisdom in specific to women's health. I myself have incorporated some of these practices in my life. For example, I understand the play of Vata and Pitta Dosha during menstruation and avoid eating super spicy or salty food or even too much of raw food during that time. I also give myself plenty of physical rest along with mental rest by not consuming anything on social media that is more likely to disturb my peace. These couple of changes were simple to make. I can definitely see the positive impact of it on my life as I don't suffer anymore from the monthly painful cramps or unnecessary bloating. Thank you so much, Sinu ma'am, for simplifying and putting this crucial yet so misunderstood topic into perspective for our audience today. I am sure that every person watching this, irrespective of their gender, has so much to take away from today's show.
Thank you so much, Bhavna, for having me and for this lovely conversation. And I hope that those who are listening will learn something new from it. Thank you.
Namaskaram.
Namaste.
Thank you for watching our Sunday special show. If you like our content and would like to contribute, then you can use the UPI ID in our description box below. Please like and share this video and subscribe to our channel. Follow our social media handles, and we will be back again next week with another Sunday special. Thank you. Namaste.